I'm so glad y'all are all here. I'd like to know how many of you are high schoolers? Okay, junior high? Okay, elementary school? First, second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth grade? Okay, kindergartners? Do I have any kindergartners? And I have some that are waiting to be in school, it looks like. I'm so excited y'all are all here. I did homeschool for 22 years. I started when my children were in preschool, and I homeschooled them all the way through high school graduation. I have four children. So it was back in the day before Leaper was even decided. So I remember the times of being afraid that truant officers would show up at my door. So anyway, I did it a long time. I know that all of you are here to learn about teaching your children about creation, so I'm excited to share some things with you that we've discovered along the way. After my oldest daughter, graduated from high school, she went into college, and she was at a secular state university. And she was taking a philosophy class, and her professor, we'll just call him Dr. Green, just to be safe here, but Dr. Green also had a seminary degree, and somewhere along the line, he became disillusioned with God. And at one point, he said he identified as an atheist, and somewhere else, he decided he was an agnostic, and then he decided that he was a naturalist about the time that Karis was taking this class. And she said that early in the semester, he opened the class with a discussion about Romans 9, where you have the story of the potter and the clay. And he was using that potter and the clay story passage to discredit who he thought God was. He was using it ripped out of context to talk about how unfair God was. And as he's making his point to the class, he thinks he's, you know, being so eloquent with his story. And then he says, you know, that's the God of the Bible. And he holds up the Bible and he said, how many of y'all want to follow that God? My daughter was sitting on the front row. She raised her hand. And she said that his face instantly turned beet red. And he said, well, you want to know what I think about that? I think that God is a mean-spirited, hateful God. And then he comes to her desk, and she's on the front row. He slams his hands down on her desk and leans within an inch of her face, and he's yelling. And he says, and anyone who believes that is a mean-spirited, hateful person too. Kara said that she heard gasps going throughout the room. You know, kids were going, oh my goodness, and they couldn't believe that this professor was doing this. I don't know about you. I don't know how I could have handled that. You know, think about it. Think if you're sitting there, you're a college student, and your college professor is yelling at you in front of the class. And it's because of your faith, what you believe about the Bible. Now put your child, kids, put yourself in that position. How would you respond? Now my daughter, you know, she is confident in her faith. She said, she just sat. I was like, Karis, what did you do? She said, Mom, I just sat there and smiled. She said, I was shocked. I didn't know what else to do. But I heard all the kids around me. And so I thought, you know, Karis would do that. That's what my oldest child would do. My second daughter has special needs, and she has a very, very tender heart. She would have burst into tears if somebody did that to her. My son is, you know, he avoids conflict. He doesn't like that kind of stuff, but he wouldn't like somebody getting in his face and yelling at him. He probably would have, you know, folded his arms and bent back and kind of gone, get out of my face, you know, or something like that. My youngest daughter is a 5'1" petite dancer, and she probably would have punched him in the nose if he did that to her. I mean, hopefully not, but she's spunky, you know, so you don't know what would happen. The point there is that all of our children are one of a kind, unique clay. God has made them all special. They have special gifts, and they're going to all respond to things like that in their own way. The thing that we as parents want to do is we want to make sure that we prepare them for the opposition that they will face. And unfortunately, it's not going to just be when they're in high school or college. when, I'm sorry, I'm sitting here talking to you and I didn't even give y'all my potter in the clay. There we go. There's the potter in the clay story. Unfortunately, they're going to face it a lot younger than high school and college. Some of our kids will face it when they're very, very young, and it's actually creeping into so many of our textbooks and children's books. I have a friend whose child in kindergarten, the kindergarten teacher found out that the child's father was a pastor, and so the kindergarten teacher loved just trying to stump the child. Can God create a rock so big he can't lift? You know, she would come up with questions like that, and the child would come home from school and say, Mommy, I don't know, you know, and so the mom, Tracy, was just trying to undo everything that this teacher was doing. So there's a lot of undermining of our faith when our children are young. A few years ago, someone introduced me to a interesting little book. It was a simple science book. It was in a really entertaining format, colorful, interesting looking. It was one that small children would like you to read to them, but maybe older, independent children in elementary school would enjoy reading it themselves. I thought I had stumbled upon an obscure little science book. I turned it over to see how wrong I was. There on the back cover of that book, this is a Basher book series is what it's called, but there was a big red button on the back and it said over 2 million sold. And this book is marketed to children in elementary school ages. I mean, the reading level gets a little bit higher in some places, but it was basically an elementary school level. And I thought, oh my goodness, 2 million sold. That means 2 million young minds have been influenced by this. Now, I thought it was a friendly book, but as I dug into it, it had a lot of references to evolution. And I saw that it was really a little book with big lies. And so many kids have been influenced by it. So let's take a look at some of the quotes in these books. In that physics book that I just showed you, it starts off in one spot it says, "Let there be me," and the world became a reality. "Your eyes have evolved to be sensitive to me." Wow. Does that bother you? I mean, on so many levels, I mean, they're personifying light, but they've taken a Bible reference and they've twisted it to fit with the evolution story. And then look at this book, this biology book. There's a reference here where it says, in millions of years, it's talking about plants and seeds developing in millions of years. And then in this dinosaurs book, in that same series, we see more references to millions of years. And then here we see a reference where they say that dinosaurs are the ancestors of birds. This is in direct opposition to what the book of Genesis tells us, where every creature is created after its own kind. And in this astronomy book here, we read that the Big Bang is the best theory of how the universe was created. And it says, at first, this is the quote, "At first there was nothing, and then in fractions of a second, I created all matter, energy, and order." But wait a second. Think about what our children are reading here. Here in this book, this lovely book that looks so entertaining, there's the message that evolution is a fact. We see things evolving, we see millions of years, we see the Big Bang creating everything, we see dinosaurs as ancestors of birds. So it makes you kind of wonder, okay, can I trust a book when I pick it up? So I'll give you a few red flags to look for when you're looking at resources for your children. Be wary if you see the word prehistoric. It arose millions of years, long ages of time, evolution, uniformitarian, feathered dinosaurs, survival of the fittest, natural selection, transitional forms, missing links, and it could go on and on. We see so many of these words, but those are some that you'd want to watch for when you're evaluating resources for your children. But we find it not only in textbooks and science books, we find it in literature, in history, in other subjects. We find it in TV programs, movies, phone and tablet apps. Kids, can you name some places where you've seen evolution taught? Somebody just tell me. Where have you seen evolution? Yeah, go ahead.
The zoo.
The zoo, that's right. You see it on the placards in the zoo all the time, don't you? Yes. Museums, oh yes, you see them all over the place in museums. You won't find it here, though. So we're so glad that you're here. But you're right, you find it in museums and zoos. You hear it in the classroom, and you even hear it in some churches. Evolution is presented as fact almost everywhere we look. And you might say, these are some of the places, you might say, what's the big deal? You know, why are we making a big deal out of creation and evolution? See if any of these comments sound familiar to you. Creation isn't a salvation issue. Creation is too divisive in the church. It doesn't really matter how we got here. It's where we're going and how we get there that matters. Science provides the answers. Leave that debate to scientists. Let's not make a big deal of it. We hear that a lot. But before you take that advice, stop and consider. I told you a few minutes ago that this questioning of creation hits at the very heart of your child's faith. Here's why the creation evolution topic is so very important to your child's faith, and how evolution erodes what they think about God. If we can't be confident that the very first book of the Bible is providing a true, accurate account of history, how can we be confident in what it tells us about Jesus or about salvation? Jesus himself believed Genesis was accurate. He quoted Genesis as being historical. He referenced the historicity of Adam and Eve in Mark 10, 5 through 7, the murder of Abel in Luke 11, 47 through 51, Noah's flood in Luke 17, 26 through 27. And he said, if I've told you earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things? John 3, 12. And he also said, but if you do not believe his, referring to Moses' writings, how will you believe my words? That was in John 5, 47. This creation topic strikes at the very heart of your child's faith. So if you discredit the first chapters of Genesis, how can you trust the rest of Scripture? Your child will be confused and they'll sense the inconsistency. And that could cause doubt to take root in their hearts. Can I really believe the Bible? Is it right here but not right there? All of a sudden, creation becomes relevant. If Jesus considered it to be true, creation is a really big deal, and it does matter. So we need to be talking about it in our churches, in our schools, in our homes. We need to teach our children about creation. We do face some challenges, though. Evolution, as we just said, is everywhere. Also, our children are unequipped. By that, I mean, we've got smart kids. I mean, I can tell by looking at you. We've got a smart bunch of kids here. The problem is that they're very vulnerable to authoritative sources. You know, a scientist says something and they say, oh, but science teaches this. Well, we've taught our kids to respect authority. And then all of a sudden there's this dilemma of, oh, the science teacher is teaching me this, or I read it here at this museum, or the docent at the museum said this. And so our children face the dilemma of knowing what, you know, what's true and what's not. And then we also have the challenge that we sometimes as parents and as teachers feel unequipped to teach the science. We don't always know how to tackle some of those questions, say, about Big Bang or soft tissue and fossils. And so we kind of, it just makes us uncomfortable trying to tackle those issues. But y'all are here today and we can do this. We're going to figure out the things that are important that we need to focus in on, and you'll leave, I hope, feeling like you've got some things that will help you with that process. There's a few things that you can do to make it easy, though, before we get into the creation topic itself. I would say, and you all know this, first, introduce your child to the creator of the universe. It doesn't matter how many facts or how much knowledge we puff our kids up with or how much data we fill their heads with, if they don't have a relationship with Jesus, then we're missing the mark on what's really important in life. So I would say introduce your children to the creator of the universe, and Jesus was the creator. While salvation is a work of the Holy Spirit, I mean, you can't force your child to accept Christ. The Holy Spirit will do that. But you can live your faith in your home in front of your child. You can let your child watch you as you depend on him and as you pray and as you seek his wisdom. And just as you deal with your daily details of life, depending on him. And that goes a long, long way. Your young child will notice that. Once your child has accepted Christ and the Holy Spirit lives within them, the Holy Spirit teaches them and leads them into all truth. It makes teaching them about God so much easier if they have a heart that already belongs to him. And when their hearts belong to him, they will hunger for truth. The second thing you can do is to be a good ambassador of Christ in your home. This goes along with having a good relationship with your child. Just remember that you're the image bearer of God in your home. And so when your children look at you, they're going to look at you and say, I wonder if God's like them. I know we're not perfect. And believe me, I am not going to heap blame on any of us because we all do the best we can. I have four kids, and I know some of y'all have more than that. It's hard being a parent. So I want you to know that I sympathize with all the struggles that you go through. But several years ago, I heard a pastor say something, and it kind of stuck with me in those early years. He said, "You want to know how to raise an atheist? Get up every morning at 6 and have your quiet time. Go to church every Sunday, Wednesday, Thursday night. Pray before every meal. Tithe on the gross. And then be harsh at home." And he said, "I can assure you, your child will want nothing to do with your God." Now, that's kind of harsh, so I hate to leave that there. So why don't we turn that illustration around on its head and say, well, what if, certainly we don't want to be a stumbling block to our children. So what if we got up and spent time in the Word because we just couldn't wait to spend time with our Lord? Or what if we prayed before our meals because we're so grateful for God's provision? And what if we go to church because we just love being with God's people? And then we're kind at home. I think that makes a big impact on your children when they see that you can be kind with them and you're telling them about Jesus in the process. The third thing you can do is encourage questions. And we all know our kids like to ask questions. How many times a day do you hear the question, "Why, Mommy? Why, Daddy?" I mean, we've all heard that. We've all been there. But a really important question that you want to teach your children is, says who? Teach them to evaluate the sources. What are the biases of the source? Analyze the information. Does it follow good science? Does it contradict the Bible? Help them find reliable answers based on the science. Build critical thinking skills. I've seen a definition of critical thinking as the ability to apply reasoning and logic to new or unfamiliar ideas, opinions, and situations. Thinking critically involves seeing things in an open-minded way and examining an idea or concept from as many angles as possible. When our children are free to ask questions, they will discover the truth, and that will give them the confidence. So, where do you want to start? Again, start at the very beginning. Start with Jesus. He's our creator. Colossians 1:16 tells us that by him, all things were created that are in heaven and on earth. All things were created through him and for him. Your child needs a relationship with Jesus. It's the most important creation teaching I can give you. When you want to look at the details of creation, you can go back to Genesis and start at the very beginning of the Bible. Start with those very first words. I bet some of you kids here know what Genesis 1:1 says. Can someone tell me what it says? I see you over there. You want to tell me? That's right. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And we could even start with just a very little part of that verse. In the beginning, God. God was there at the very beginning of everything. He's the only truly eyewitness account of creation comes from our Creator, and it's recorded in the book of Genesis. The Bible is the Word of God, so we can believe it. The Bible provides an accurate history of the universe. So teach your children the history of the universe and start with the Creator's own words in Genesis. And when you're starting with creation, you want to start with three events: creation, fall, and flood. Kids, y'all want to repeat that with me? Creation, fall, and flood. That's right. And our mighty Creator made everything in 6 days. On day one, He created light. On day two, He separated the waters. On day three, He made the dry land appear. Day four, the sun, moon, and the stars. Day five, He created the sea animals and the birds. And day six, He created land animals and humans. So why is the fall important? Why do you think we talk about the fall? Well, that's when the sin entered the world, and the very first death as a result of that sin. Evolution is based on false information, the idea that death was occurring for millions of years before humans ever lived. But the Bible tells us that death was a direct result of human sin. Romans 5:12 says, "Therefore, just as through one man sin entered the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men because all sinned." So why is a worldwide flood important? A global flood, Noah's flood, explains what we see with fossils, sedimentary layers, the extinction of many animals, the ice age, and so much more. Evidence of the flood reminds us that when God warns us of a coming judgment, He follows through. The Bible says that people in the time before the flood lived as though the judgment would never come, even though Noah had preached to them over many years. The ark, well, that points to Christ as our salvation. While the ark was a real thing, you look at it and you think it provided refuge, but it serves for us as a picture of God's marvelous grace. Jesus provides redemption and restoration for us. Okay, so we've laid the groundwork. Now, I can tell you, we hear a lot of questions. And some of the questions we hear over and over. And, you know, I'm not a scientist, but we've got some young ICR scientists in the room that are going to help me with some of these questions that we face. The first question, What about dinosaurs? Where do they fit in the Bible? Where's my list, Christy? There it is. Sienna. I think Sienna's going to help me with this one.
On day six of creation, God created land animals, including dinosaurs.
Yay! Thank you. Yeah, so the question, what about dinosaurs? How do they fit in the Bible? So as Sienna and her mother pointed out, here's the short answer. They were created on day six of creation, the same day that other land animals and humans were created. The behemoth that God pointed out in Job 40, verses 15 through 24, may have been a long-necked sauropod. Sometimes you'll hear some comment, or you'll read some commentaries, or you'll hear some preachers say that it was probably a hippo, but the description includes a tail like a cedar, and hippos really don't have a tail like a cedar. They have, you know, that little curlicue thing, you know, so it doesn't really fit that description. So we kind of think that the behemoth was probably a long-necked sauropod. We do have some great resources on dinosaurs if you want to dig deeper. I'm giving you short answers to these 10 questions that we get, but we have so many resources that can help you with it. These are some of the resources for the children in preschool, elementary, and even junior high for the Guide to Dinosaurs book. Okay, the second question we hear a lot is, did we come from apes? Or you may hear it, did we evolve from chimp-like ancestors? And I think Carter's going to help me with this. Our ICR young scientist, Carter, are you here? He's going to tell us what he knows about this one.
But the Bible tells us that God made animals and humans separately. each like their own kind. We have a common designer who used some of the same design features in both of us.
Thank you, Carter. Yay! I'm going to give you a hand on that. Appreciate that. Yes, he just pointed out that the Bible tells us that God created humans in his own image on day six of creation. Humans are unique in all creation, and humans are not animals. God created every living creature after its own kind, and it stays within its kind. Kind is not the same as species. For example, there may be many species of dog, but they're all of the dog kind. Kinds are distinct groups of creatures that most likely could only reproduce with other creatures in their same kind. We also have somebody that's going to read to us. Let's see. Sadie. Sadie's reading from our God Made Gorillas, God Made You book.
We are made in God's image, so special, with talent and imagination. Though everything that God made is good, people are his best creation.
That's right. Thank you so much, Sadie. We appreciate that. And by the way, the book that she just read was written by Christy Hardy, who is the lady that's holding the books and helping our young scientists today. So Christy's an editor here. So, okay, the third question that we hear often is, could God have used the Big Bang in the beginning? So, could God have used the Big Bang to create the universe? I'm going to need some more help here. I have Thomas that's going to help us with this question. Thomas?
The Big Bang story says everything formed over billions of years, but the Bible's beginnings tell of only a six-day creation just thousands of years ago. If the Big Bang were true, that would mean living creatures died for millions of years before humans ever existed. But the Bible says death being after Adam and Eve sinned.
Thank you so much, Christopher, Thomas. That was wonderful. You did a great job reading that. And by the way, these books that they're reading from are resources that we've developed to help you, and I'll show you which books they are here at the end of the talk if you'd like to see that. But the short answer to the question of could God have used the Big Bang to create the universe? No, he did not create the world the way the Big Bang model explains the origin of the universe. You know, I don't know what it sounded like when God said, "Let there be light," and light suddenly appeared. But the Big Bang model that you hear about, or that evolutionists propose today, it assumes that creation took billions of years. It implies death before sin. And it contains other science problems and premises that, quite frankly, I can't explain to you. But Dr. Cupps and Dr. Hebert can do that for you. And we do have resources that have those explanations in them. This is one of my favorite passages here. Psalm 33, 6 through 7 and 9 says, "By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made. He gathers the waters of the sea together as a heap. He lays up the deep in the storehouses, for he spoke and it was done. He commanded and it stood fast." The Bible tells us that God spoke and all creation stood firm. It appeared immediately. Okay, here's another question. How old is the universe? I don't have a helper on that one because I can tell you that. That comes from the Bible. The short answer is, according to the biblical timeline of history, the universe is only thousands of years old. ICR biblical scholars and scientists put the age of the universe at about 6,000 years. So we also hear this question quite a bit. Are aliens out in space somewhere? This is a tricky question, and I do have a young scientist that's going to help us with this one. Christopher.
Wait, is it this one? And the Bible states that Earth was specifically designed for life. Jesus became a human to offer himself as a substitute for us. Adam's descendants Even if aliens were real, they wouldn't be related to Christ, and therefore Christ didn't die for them. If they can't be saved, then God would be unjust.
Very good. Thank you so much, Christopher, for that. Appreciate it. I'm going to clap for you. So the short answer to the question is no, particularly if it's about intelligent life. The Bible seems to imply that Earth is unique among creation, made on day one of the creation week. But the other planets and stars were created on day four. So there's something different about Earth. Earth is home to humans who are made in the image of God. And this is the page that our young Christopher just read from. This is the page he read from, and it comes from our Guide to Creation Basics book. Okay, we also hear, was there a worldwide flood? And the short answer to that question is yes. Noah's flood covered the entire planet. The Bible tells us that. The flood was a catastrophic event and is the best way to explain major geologic features on Earth's surface. Number seven, do fossils or the fossil record provide evidence for evolution? And I think Caleb is going to help us with that one.
Fossils show that each creature has the same basic look no matter where it appears in Earth's rock layers.
Very good. Thank you, Caleb. Appreciate that. My son's name is Caleb. Okay, so the short answer to this question is no. Fossils provide evidence of a catastrophic flood. Soft tissue and dinosaur fossils provides evidence that they can't be very old. And fossils show varieties of basic kinds, but not something turning from one kind into another kind. Also, fossils had to have formed fast since animals' bodies would have been scavenged or rotted away. The flood provided a rapid burial of billions of creatures, which is what was needed to fossilize them. Okay, we also get this question. Do missing links exist? The short answer to this is no. Undisputed transitional forms don't exist. The key there is in the undisputed part. Our scientists often say the missing links are still missing. We have an appendix in our book, The Fossil Record, that Mr. Frank Sherwin, one of our scientists here, did, and it's a very good explanation of the transitional forms and the missing links. Now, it's written at a higher level than a lot of the children would be, but the high school kids would get a lot out of that, and probably some of the junior high kids as well. But anyway, that's one. If you're interested in missing links, that's the resource I would recommend for that. Number nine, is adaptation the same as evolution? When people say evolution, they're usually referring to what scientists call macroevolution. So the answer to the question is no. This is a quote from our Dr. Brian Thomas talking about this, and basically the point that he's making in this very difficult quote here is that evolution is typically described as a natural process that generates new biological structures. Macroevolution is the term used to describe changing from one kind of creature into another, and that does not happen. And there's no evidence that it ever happened. We don't see dogs turn into cats. No animal kind changes into another animal kind. Darwin kind of supposed it this way. You know, you see the scribbled words there, I think. He supposed that it might have happened this way, that all living creatures came from one ancestor that originated millions and millions of years ago. But he was wrong. All creatures don't come from one ancestor, and they don't change from one kind of creature into another. Have I made that point sufficiently? There's no evidence that it's ever happened. This is actually a more accurate illustration to show how created kinds are related. Notice all the separate kinds do not come from the same ancestor. The Bible says that God created every animal after its own kind. Here we see a lion and a tiger produce a liger, and a horse and a zebra produce a zorse, but you're not going to see a liger become a zorse. These are examples of variations within a kind, not of evolution. Adaptation, again, this is another description from Dr. Thomas, I think. Yes. It refers to limited changes within a kind. God designed creatures to adapt to their environment. The incredible mechanisms that enable these adaptive changes were designed within them. Did I say it right, Dr. Galuza? He's back there. He's the expert on this, so anyway. When our skin tans as a result of exposure to sun, that's an example of adaptation by design. When our muscles get big because we lift weights, or we've done heavy labor, or we've worked out for a sport like football, that's an example of adaptation. Our body's ability to adapt is God's wonderful design in the human body, and it's another reason for us to worship our Creator. Okay, the 10th question. Could the word day in the Genesis creation account mean a longer period of time than a 24-hour day? Okay, I know the kids probably haven't asked this question. This would be a question that most of you parents would ask. Some of you high school kids might ask this too. But anyway, it's actually a very important question. The short answer is no. The Hebrew word yom in Genesis 1 refers to a normal 24-hour day. We know this because yom is limited by the modifying terms evening and morning. The author of Genesis, Moses, goes out of his way to emphasize that these were normal 24-hour days by bookending the term with morning and evening, which are characteristics of a normal 24-hour day. And each time this term is used in the Old Testament, and according to our study Bible, 38 times it appears, and it means a normal day when it does. The word yom appears in Exodus 20:11, and this ties into Genesis 1, because Genesis 20:11 says, "For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day." Here we see that God used this as a template for the command given in Exodus 20:8-10, where he said, 6 days you shall labor. So he's talking about, and he says, if 20:11 days aren't normal days, then the days in 20:8-10 make no sense. So the word yom is used in the same context here for the days of the creation week in Genesis 1, a normal 24-hour day. Okay, so those are 10 very quick questions and quick answers that you might get. And I'd like to give you some resources that could help you with this. If you don't know where to go, I'd say start with the Bible. The Bible has so many references about creation. But be comfortable saying, you know, I don't know, but I know where to go. I know where we can get the answers. We can look together. And you can approach it like a treasure hunt. Start with icr.org, our website. We have thousands of articles there where you can get good information. If you haven't signed up for our Acts and Facts and Days of Praise, do that too. Okay, the books that the kids were reading from today were mainly these books here. These are our Science for Kids series books. Those are the elementary school and our Guide to series books. We also have, and these are the books, the God Made Gorillas is the book that Christy wrote. And the Big Plans for Henry was written by our very own Dr. Tim Clary. So, and those are picture books that your preschoolers would enjoy. We also have DVDs. The thing about our DVD sets that you as homeschoolers will appreciate is that they have viewer guides with them that have questions, they have key points, they have key Bible verses that apply to the topics. So these are things that you can use in your homeschool when you're doing creation unit studies. And speaking of unit studies, I have developed a 36-week creation unit study outline that shows you how to use our resources, starting from the very basic information going to the most complicated. This is available on our website, and guys, it's a really good deal. It's 50% off the retail, and you get so many resources in it. It's very, very helpful. Now, the creation unit study outline, don't get your hopes up. It's not like a big it's not a big plan. It's just a one-page outline. In fact, I think I've got one right here. I'll show it to you. It's just a one-page outline that shows you the sequence to follow, and it gives you some other activities that you might want to do, but I don't want you to think that it's, you know, a big curriculum. Also, you can follow us on our social media, and one thing that you'll want to do is take advantage of our family memberships here at the Discovery Center, because you can come here for field trips, and once you get that family membership, it's, you know, it's so much better for you. And speaking of coming back, we have Fall Fun Days next week. So you might want to come back for that. It's on November 6th and 7th. It'll be a good thing to bring your family to. So we've talked about teaching your kids, and I said, I'm not a scientist. You don't have to be a scientist or a theologian to do this, but you can do this, and you can show your children how science confirms what the Bible said. I want to go back. You know, at the beginning, I was telling you about my daughter Karis in Dr. Green's class. Well, I want to tell you how that story ended, because it's really one of those things where you just kind of go, this is really cool that this happened this way. But go back to Dr. Green's class. Okay, picture she's just been yelled at by the professor. And she walks out of the class. And remember, she was yelled at because she raised her hand and said she trusted the God of the Bible. And when she left class that day, there was a line of students waiting to talk to her. And most of them were not believers. And they had questions for her. And it didn't just happen at that class. It happened several classes afterwards. And not only that, Dr. Green allowed her, after a few weeks, he allowed her to read from Romans 7 and Romans 8 to provide a context for Romans 9. He let her read a complete chapter in class one day. So things changed in that class, and it was really interesting how God used that. But more discussions followed about the potter and the clay. About a year later, Karis was getting her applications ready for her graduate school. And she had her piles of papers. She had her essays and her transcripts and her letters of recommendation. And it was really cool. I was helping her stuff the envelopes. And right there in the middle of all of her letters of recommendations was a letter from Dr. Green, which, who would have imagined that? It doesn't always turn out that way, that you have a hostile teacher becoming a friendly advocate for you. But, you know, God can do anything, and he's our designer and our creator. I know I often, in my role as director of communications here, I'm often involved in interviews with scientists, and you'd be surprised how many of them started out as evolutionists. But somewhere along the line, someone shared the gospel with them, someone introduced them to Jesus, someone showed them how the Bible fits with science, and they became creationists. Someone. As Kara said to Dr. Green that day, he's God. He can do anything he wants to do. Maybe God wants to use you to be that someone, to touch your neighbor, your friend, your child. Because he is the potter and you are the clay that God uses. That's it. Thank you.